Hello students. So yesterday we have started with that of the types of the epithelial cells. So epithelial tissues, they are basically classified into three, that is squamous, cuboidal and columnar. When you see the squamous epithelial tissue, then you find that they are thin, flat, irregularly shaped cells are present. And these cells are closely packed with each other, and due to which there is no intercellular spaces present between them. The squamous epithelial tissues, the main function is diffusion and filtration, since it is having very thin membrane. It rests on a non-cellular membrane, that is a basement membrane. If we talk about that of the cuboidal epithelium is a cubic like a cell, that's why the name is a cuboidal epithelial tissues. These are having a nucleus, like in case of the squamous also, both of them are having the prominent nucleus present in it. Sometimes these cuboidal epithelial tissue, they get modified and have cilia and become a ciliated cuboidal epithelium. Its main function is absorption. Now the third one is the columnar epithelial tissue, students. So columnar, the name is given because of its shape, because it is a column-like cells are present in it. They are having the nucleus also, but the nucleus is present at the base or at the periphery region. Sometimes the columnar epithelial tissue also get modified. They have, if they are having cilia on its free surface, it becomes ciliated columnar epithelial tissue. If it is having a finger-like a projection or a brush-like a border at its free surface, we call it a brush border columnar epithelial tissues. And if suppose it is develops a glands in it, that is goblet cells are present in it, we will call it a glandular columnar epithelial tissues. So its main function, it help in absorption, it help in secretion. Okay, now today we will see that what is the basic difference between that of the squamous and columnar epithelial tissue. So now we will see the difference between that of the squamous epithelium to that of the columnar epithelium. Okay, students. So squamous epithelium is what? You see, when you see the squamous epithelium, you find that the component of the cell of that of the squamous epithelium, they are thin as well as flat. So you find that the squamous epithelium is a flat surface, is a hexagonal flat like a structure. Okay, as well as it is having a thin membrane. But when you see that of the columnar epithelium, then you will find that the structure is a column shape. Okay, and that is why the name is given columnar. Okay, so it is a column shape or pillar like a structure. Okay, so because of its column like a shape, it appears like a pillar. So here it is appears like that of the thin and flat, and here the component of the cell, they appear like that of the pillar. When you see the second one, then see that the nucleus which is present in that of the squamous epithelium, it lies in the center of the cell and which is generally bulges out. So we can say that in case of a squamous epithelium, a flat like a structure is there, and in between you will find a prominent nucleus is present in it, and that nucleus seems to be comes out. So okay, so we call it that it generally bulged out. Okay, as well as it is present at the center of the cell. While if you see that of the columnar epithelium, then you student, you find that in this column shape structure, the nucleus is basically present at the base. Okay, so here the nucleus is present in the center and it is prominent. okay, and that's why it appears bulges out. While in case of that of the, while in that of the columnar, it is located near the base of the cell. Third difference between that of the squamous and the columnar epithelium is on the basis of their location. So if you see that of the squamous epithelium, so it is, you know that the membrane is thin. So thin membrane help in the proper diffusion as well as that of the filtration process. So basically the location of that of the squamous epithelium is in the lung, in alveoli, in the blood capillaries, in the Bowman's capsule. You know the Bowman's capsule is responsible for the filtration, and the buccal cavity and skin. So you see all these membrane, skin is the outer surface. So all these tissues or all these parts, they having that of the different, having that of the squamous epithelium tissue in it. Lung alveoli and the blood capillaries, you know the diffusion process, exchange of the gases take place here properly. Bowman's capsule or the buccal cavity is there. The buccal cavity or the Bowman's capsule, these all are responsible for the filtration. Okay, and skin is the outer surface. So you see it is present where the diffusion and that of the filtration process occur. Although it is outer, so very it is not very effective, but somehow it also act as a protective layer. Now if you see in that of the columnar epithelium, student, so columnar epithelium, it occurs within the layer of the stomach and intestine. You know the columnar epithelium is present where the process of absorption take place. Okay, so you know that the stomach and that of the intestine is that part where the process of absorption take place properly. Okay, not only this, glands are there. So glands as well as that of the epiglottis. So these all are the part of the digestive system, and this consisting of the columnar epithelium. Basic function of that of the columnar epithelium is absorption. Now see here, that was on the basis of the location. Now we will talk about the difference between them on the basis of their function. So if you see, student, in case of the squamous epithelium, here the function of the squamous epithelium, it act as a selectively permeable barrier. Okay, so it acts as a selectively permeable membrane which allow only few particles to pass through it. Okay, it is used in the ultrafiltration and wear and tear. Since it is acting as a protective tissue, so in the when I get injury and our organs get injured, then it will help it to heal it. So its function, it act as a selectively permeable membrane. It help in ultrafiltration, especially in that of the nephron in Bowman's capsule, as well as it help in a wear and tear. While if you see in case of a columnar epithelium, student, so this columnar epithelium, basically the function is that it help in absorption. So it take parts in absorption, and that is why it is present in the layer of the stomach and intestine, as well as it act as a secretion, and that's why it is present in the glands, because glands are responsible for secretion of the hormones. So it help in absorption, it help in secretion, as well as it act as a protective covering. Okay, so it help in covering the epiglottis. It means it help in protecting the organs also. So this is the difference between that of the squamous and the columnar epithelium on the basis of their shape, on the basis of their location of the nucleus, on the basis of their location in the body, as well as their function. So we had discussed that of the squamous epithelium, cuboidal epithelium, and that of the columnar epithelium. as well as there are two more type of epithelium, that is glandular epithelium and that of the ciliated epithelium. When we talk about the glandular epithelium, students, we already had discussed in that of the columnar epithelium, that is the columnar epithelium show a modification. And that modification is what, in which this columnar epithelium, some of the cell, they get modified and start secreting the substances. So they act as a glands. Okay, so the columnar epithelium is, we can say it is often modified to form glands, and these glands secretes chemicals. And such kind of epithelium which is having that of the modified glands in it is known as the glandular epithelium. Now when we say that it get converted or it get modified to form gland, such cells we call it a goblet cells. Okay, so these goblet cells, they are the glands, they act as a gland which help in secretion. It secretes chemical and thus they make the columnar epithelium into a columnar glandular epithelium. Okay, so this is the glandular epithelium. Now if we talk of that of the ciliated epithelium, students, so you see that either sometimes happen that of the cuboidal or that of the columnar cells. In both the cases, you know that they are having the free surface and that free surface get a border. Okay, or we can say that free border, it bears a thread-like cytoplasmic outgrowth and that we call as a cilia. Okay, so cuboidal or that of the columnar cell, sometimes it happens they get modified and due to which a thread-like cytoplasmic outgrowth starts having on that of the free border. Okay, and that outgrowth we call it a cilia. And such cell which consisting of these cilia, we termed as them ciliated epithelium. Okay, so if it is from that of the cuboidal epithelium, if it occurs in that of the cuboidal epithelium free border, we use the term that is ciliated cuboidal epithelium tissue. If it occur on that of the columnar free border, then we use the term ciliated columnar epithelium tissue. Now, occurrence, you see that this ciliated cuboidal epithelium, it is basically found in the sperm duct. Okay, last time also we discussed about that these are basically present in the seminiferous tubules. Okay, as well as in that of the oviduct. Okay, so these are present in that of the sperm duct. While in case of a ciliated columnar epithelium lines, they are basically present in the lining of your windpipe, that is trachea, as well as it is present in the bronchi, which is the lung, kidney tubule, as well as in the fallopian tube. Okay, so this ciliated cuboidal epithelium is found in the sperm duct, while that of the columnar epithelium, it is present in the bronchi, trachea, kidney tubules and oviduct, especially that of the fallopian tube. Now, what is the function of this ciliated epithelial tissue? That the rhythmic beating of the cilia, it helps in moving the solid particle, example that of the mucus, especially in the one direction through the ducts. So basically the function of the cilia, that it helps in moving the solid particle in one direction. And that's why it is present. If suppose it is present in that of the fallopian tube, so it used to carry the zygote from the fallopian tube to the uterus. The same thing with that of the
If it is present in the trachea, in the windpipe, so along with the mucus, it help in removing or throwing that of the dust particle outside. So basically, its function is to throw out that of the solid particles, or it help in the movement of the solid particle in one direction. Okay, so this is the glandular epithelium and ciliated epithelium. It is the modification of that of the columnar epithelium or that of the cuboidal epithelium. So we can say that it is the part of that of the columnar and the cuboidal epithelium. Although due to the change in the structure and the function, we use it in the another topic. So this is that of the epithelial tissue. Now we will start with the next one, and that is the muscular tissue. So student, muscular tissue, the term came from the muscles. Okay, it means the tissues, the cells which is present in our muscles, or the muscle cells, they constitute together to form the muscular tissues. Now the muscle tissue or the muscles of the body, they are made up of muscle cells. It means the muscle cells, they combine together to form the muscles of the body. Now if you talk about that of the muscle cells, you find that the muscle cells, they are elongated. It means they are large size. And because of that, they are elongated and large size, they are also known as a muscle fibers. Okay, you see fibers, they are large size and elongated. And that's why we call the muscle cells as a muscle fiber. So you can use anything. The muscle fibers, they constitute to form the muscular tissues, or the muscle cells are responsible for the formation of the muscles of the body. So either you can use the muscle cells or muscle fiber. Now the movement of the body, okay, if you see that of the limb, that is brought about by the contraction and relaxation of a contractile protein which are present in the muscle cells. So you know, student, that basically these muscular tissues or these muscles, they are responsible for the contraction and relaxation. Okay, so because of the muscles only, we are able to contract or relax our body. So a contractile protein is present in the muscular tissue, or we can say a contractile protein is present in the muscle cells, which are responsible for the contraction and relaxation of the muscles cell. Okay, so why we are able to move our body? It is because of the contractile protein which is present in the muscle cell. That contractile protein is responsible for the contraction and relaxation. Now you see the movement of the internal organ also. You see our lungs, it move, heart, that of the alimentary canal, okay, all these things, they move, and they all are made up of, or they all are caused, they are able to move just because of the presence of the muscular tissues in it. Okay, so because of the presence of the muscle tissue, they are able to contract, they are able to move. So even in the internal organs, muscles are present. Now the muscle cells, they are arranged parallelly with each other, and due to which you see they work together very effectively. You can see here, these are the muscle fibers, and you can see that these are parallelly attached with each other. All the muscle fibers, they are parallel with each other, and together they constitute together and work together very effectively. Okay, so these muscle fibers or the muscle cells, they are elongated, they are large size, The contractile protein which is present in is responsible for the contraction and relaxation of the movement of the body, as well as our internal organ show movement, and that movement is due to the presence of the muscle cells. Now see here, on the basis of that, these muscular tissues, these muscle fibers are divided into two. And these, the division is on the basis of their location, on the basis of their structure, as well as on the basis of their function. It means their location is different, their structure is different, and their function is different. So what are the three types of the muscle fiber? The first one is the skeletal muscle. Okay? Skeletal muscle or striated muscle. The second one is the smooth muscle. The smooth muscles are that of the non-striated or unstriated muscle. Then the third one is that of the cardiac muscle. Okay? So we will start with that of the striated muscles. These striated muscles are that of the skeletal muscles. Striated muscles, they are also known as a stripped, skeletal or voluntary muscles. Okay, and that's why we can use any of the term. We can use it is a stripped muscle or a striated muscle or a skeletal muscle or a voluntary muscle. Now see why the different names are given to it. So if you see the first name, I said that it is a stripped muscle. S-T-R-I-P-E-D. It is known as that of the stripped muscle. Now if you see that of the striated muscle, you will see that the entire muscle fiber, they show the alternate dark and that of the light strips. Okay, it means they are having bands. Bands or striation. Striation means what? It means one strip is light, one strip is dark. That is an alternate. Okay, so it is like that of the band. One is white and one is that of the light color, or one is that of the different color. Okay, so that is the light or the dark strip. So these consisting of the dark and the light strip, that's why these are known as that of the stripped muscles. Okay. The second name which has been given to that of the striated muscle, it is skeletal muscle. Now see student, these muscles, they are attached to the bones. Okay, and that's why they are responsible for the bone movement. So they are attached to the bone and responsible for the body movement. That's why they are known as a skeletal muscle, because it is attached to the skeletal system. It is attached to the bones. Okay. And bones is what? It is a part of our skeletal system. Okay. So these muscles are attached to the bones, and you know that bones are responsible for the movement. So these muscles, they are responsible for the body movement, and that's why the name skeletal muscles has been given. Then the next one is last one, and that is the voluntary muscle. Okay. Voluntary. Voluntary muscles, it means that these muscles, they work according to our will. Okay, whatever or if we want to move that particular muscle, that we can move it according to our will, such kind of a muscles is known as a voluntary muscles, whose movement is in our hand. Okay, it totally depends on our will. Okay, that's why the name is given voluntary muscles. So you see here, the first name it is given, the stripped muscle. Stripped because they are having the dark and that of the light bands present in it. The second name is given is the skeletal muscle. It is because it is attached to the bones and thus responsible for the body movement. The third name is given, that is voluntary muscles. It is because we can move these muscles according to our will. Okay, so these are the different names of that of the skeletal muscles. Now, if you see the structure of the striated muscles, then you will find that they are long, they are elongated, and they are non-tapering. Okay, you see here, this is a long one. They are long. It is long here. Okay, non-tapering, elongated is there. Okay, cylindrical in shape as well as it is unbranched. It is not branched at all. So these are the features of the muscle fiber, striated muscle fiber. That it is long, elongated, non-tapering, cylindrical as well as it is unbranched. Okay, these cells, they are having the number of a nuclei. You can see here, nucleus is present here. Okay, so it consisting of the nuclei. And we can say that these muscle cells is a multinucleated. It means it consisting of a more than one nucleus in it. And that is why we are saying that a number of nuclei is present in it. Okay. Now, there is one peculiar property of these muscle cells, of all the muscle cells, is that each muscle cell is enclosed in a thin but a distinct plasma membrane, and that plasma membrane is known as sarcolemma. Okay, so all the muscle fibers, they are arranged, they are enclosed in a plasma membrane, and we call it as sarcolemma. So you see, striated muscles, it is enclosed in a thin but a distinct plasma membrane, and that we call as a sarcolemma. Okay. So the plasma membrane of the striated muscle, we use the term that is sarcolemma. Now, what about the nucleus which is present in that of the sarcolemma? So the nuclei is located just beneath the sarcolemma. It means the nuclei is in the peripheral in position. Now, in the sarcoplasm or the cytoplasm of a muscle fiber, they are embedded a large number of a contractile element, and that is known as myofibrils. Okay, so you see here, these are a different contractile elements are present there. A large number of contractile elements are embedded in this muscle fiber, in this muscle cells, and we call it a myofibril, as well as we can use one more term, that is sarcostyle. Okay, so the plasma membrane in which the which is enclosed that of the striated muscle, we use the term that is sarcolemma. And in the cytoplasm, in the sarcoplasm, the cytoplasm of the muscle is known as cytoplasm, is known as sarcoplasm. That sarcoplasm, it consisting of a large number of a contractile element, and that is known as a myofibrils. Now, what are the different location of these striated muscles, student? These striated muscles, they are basically, it occurs in the limbs or in the muscle of the limbs, especially you see in the arms, the bicep and triceps of the arms, we can move it. Okay, so it is basically present in the arms, especially in the biceps and the triceps. It is also present in the body wall. It is present in the face, in the neck, as well as it is present in the tongue, in the pharynx, in the diaphragm, upper part of the esophagus. These all consisting of the striated muscles. Now see, There is one thing is common in all these things, and that one thing is that these all the things where this created muscles is present. You see the muscles of the limbs, that is in the arms or in the face or neck region or the tongue or pharynx or the esophagus. Okay, and that of the diaphragm. You see the most of the muscles, we can move it according to our will. We can move our limbs, muscles, limb, whenever we want to do that. Or we are able to move our tongue or that of the diaphragm by ourselves only. Okay, so what is this? This is the muscle by which we can control or which we can move according to our will, and that is why the name is given the voluntary muscles. Now if you see the functions of these striated muscles, so you see student, the skeletal muscle, it produces movement. Okay, so it is present, it is attached with the bones, and that is why it is responsible for the body movement. Okay, so the contraction by pulling on tendon and moving that of the bones of the skeleton. So we can say that since it is attached to the bones, so if we are moving our bones, the muscle will also help in the movement. Okay. So these muscles, they provide the movement as well as it also help in the locomotion of the body. The second thing, that maintain posture. Okay, so it help in maintaining the body posture. Okay, example, if you are holding your head up or you are standing, it was just because of the striated muscles. Generate heat. You see student, when you are continuously contracting or relaxing, when you are rapid contraction occur, due to which the body temperature increases. So we can say that they generate heat as they contract, and this help in maintaining the normal body temperature. Okay, so it help in generating the heat by rapid contraction or by contraction. It stabilizes joint, so the tendons of the muscles, because it is attached to the tendons, it is attached to the bones, so the tendons of the muscle, they extend over the joints. Okay, so these muscles, they help in stabilizing that of the joints. So this is the function of the skeletal muscle. Skeletal muscles, they help in the movement, they help in maintaining the posture, they help in generating the heat, as well as it help in stabilizing the joints. Okay, so this is the striated muscle or skeletal muscle of the muscular tissue.